we've not really talked about carbon isotope yet. Carbon can be a bit more complicated. The ultimate source of carbon is the mantle and its volcanic degassing. And that source is about at roughly -5 per mil PdB. So slightly negative. In the ocean, what happens is that you have a lot of photosynthesis taking place. And photosynthetic organisms will tend to prefer the lighter C12 because it's easier to break bonds between C12 atoms than between a C12 and a C13 or two C13. So that means that the organic tissues and the sugars will be quite depleted. So that you will have negative composition, maybe -15, -20, -30. It depends on exactly what biological pathway you're using. But the flip side is it means that the ocean is enriched in C13 because that C13 that is not incorporated into tissues is actually available for mineralization. So the carbonates will have a tendency of, marine carbonates will have a tendency of plotting slightly higher than the organic tissues. And of course, because the belemnite that we use as our reference, the PdB, is a Mesozoic carbonate, then Mesozoic carbonates are plotting around zero. Modern carbonates fluctuate a little bit from that, so you have a range of different values. It gets really interesting when you look at things like peat, wood, because, or coal, because they're coming from organic tissues. They tend to be more negative in terms of their carbon isotope composition. And things like oil and natural gas are also quite negative. They plot, you know, around -20, -40, and bacterial methane is probably the lightest product, plotting at around -60, -80 per mil. So very, very depleted compared to that source of carbon that the volcanic degassing is. And that's because of the bacterial processes that lead to the formation of that methane. What's interesting is to also look at water. So groundwater and freshwater have a delta C13 ranging between -20 to +20. And that big range has a lot to do with the source of the water, the amount of organic carbon that's dissolved in it, the amount of carbonates that's dissolved in it, and the interaction that the water had with the host rock. Okay, so we're back on the joyless resolution. So now we've seen how we measure stable isotopes, but why are they so useful? Why can we use them in stratigraphy? And to understand this, we need to remember where we are, in the middle of the ocean, and that most sediments are deposited in the ocean. So let's look at some fundamental properties of the ocean. So here you have a picture of the global ocean circulation. And what I want you to realize is that all of the oceans are connected by one big circulation system that we call the conveyor belt. In blue, you have cool subsurface current, and in red, you have warm surface currents. And one thing to realize is that if you look at the Northern Atlantic, the North Atlantic, we tend to have here cool water that sinks. It's cool, dense water because it's very saline, that sinks into the bottom of the ocean. And that motion of the water sinking is what basically pushes and entrains the whole conveyor belt and entrains the whole circulation. And of course, because you sink water in the North Atlantic, at some point it needs to come back up, and it's actually in the North Pacific that you have upwelling of that cold water. That's why on the coast of North America you have so much upwelling of nutrient-rich, cool, deep waters. And the point, the main point here, is that this whole circulation takes about 1,600 years. So it's, by standards of geological timescale, it's a very, very, very fast circulation. So one thing to realize is that organisms that live at the bottom of the ocean, in particular benthic foraminifers, will record that history of carbon isotope and oxygen isotope change. And that led to some really useful work in paleoceanography, and in particular, I'm showing you a compilation from Jim Zakas here, where you have the oxygen isotopes on the left and the carbon isotopes on the right. And this compilation is from all oceans of the world, and it's benthic foraminifer, oxygen and carbon isotope. And the point really, the important point to realize is that there is a pattern in the change in oxygen isotopes and in carbon isotopes. So let's start with oxygen isotopes. This is for the last 65 million years. You can see that during the Eocene, we actually have broadly light oxygen isotopes in our benthic record. And this is because the ocean is very warm at that period. And you can see that this warmth is followed by an episode of cooling because the oxygen isotopes are shifting to higher values. And that cooling is very well expressed at the beginning of the Oligocene, where we have the OI1 glaciation, which is a massive shift in oxygen isotope. Now, this shift, because it's linked to a glaciation, happens worldwide. It's something you can record everywhere. And so it's a very good isotopic marker, a very good time marker. Then we have in the early Miocene a warming episode that's known as the early Miocene warming. And again, this shift can be seen anywhere. And it's followed then by, of course, cooling in the late Miocene, cooling that eventually leads to the final cooling that leads eventually to the Holocene cooling that we know today and to the Quaternary glaciations. And again, this pattern of oxygen isotope can be recognized everywhere in sediments. So if you can reconstruct it in your sediments, you can use this as a chemostratigraphic tool. Carbon isotope is similar. So we can see spikes in carbon isotopes. So here I'm showing you the PTM. That's the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum that is characterized by a very big shift in carbon isotope towards lighter carbon isotope values. But spikes in carbon isotopes linked to productivity of the oceans can be global or local. A lot of them are global, and it's not limited to the PTM. Here's another example. In the Miocene, we have a very interesting tie between carbon and oxygen isotopes. And it's this type of ties that can be exploited to basically reconstruct a chemostratigraphic record.